Good morning and welcome to the 21st meeting of 2022 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business this morning is a declaration of interest from Graeme Simpson, MSP, who joins the committee today, replacing Alexander Burnett. I would like to take this opportunity to place on record my thanks to Alexander Burnett for his work on the committee and wish him well in his new role. I'm pleased to welcome Graeme Simpson, who I know was a member of the Economy Committee in the previous session, and invite him to declare any relevant interests.
I have no interest to declare.
Thank you. Our next item of business is a decision to take items 6 and 7 in private. Are people content with that? Thank you. And now we'll move on to the evidence session on Consumer Scotland Transfer of Functions Regulations 2022. And I refer members to Paper 1 and welcome to the meeting Tom Arthur, Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth, who is joined by Neil Ritchie, Head of Unit, Energy Services and Consumer Policy, and Susan Robb, Solicitor with the Scottish Government. And I invite the Minister to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the Committee. I'm grateful for the opportunity here to speak to the Draft Consumer Scotland Transfer of Functions Regulations 2022. These regulations are, in effect, the final piece of the jigsaw in implementing the Consumer Scotland Act 2020. Earlier sets of regulations have already been through Parliament, as well as the UK government order pertaining to reserved aspects. The Consumer Scotland Transfer Functions Regulations 2022, in their simplest form, will add Consumer Scotland or replace references to Citizens Advice Scotland with Consumer Scotland in Scottish Acts to allow the transferring or the sharing of functions between the two consumer bodies. This is a technical instrument which brings transparency around the transfer of functions and also recognises Consumer Scotland as Scotland's independent consumer advocate. The functions transferred relate to the devolved policy responsibility of water. Without the transfer of functions from CAS to Consumer Scotland in the areas of consumer advocacy and general advice, Consumer Scotland would not be able to carry out its duties. Now, you may be wondering why we are not transferring all functions to Consumer Scotland. Consumer in Scotland and CAS, although both consumer bodies, have extremely different roles to play within the consumer landscape. CAS will continue to provide advice via its network of bureaus and the Extra Help Unit. Consumer Scotland, as part of their statutory functions, have the ability to provide advice along with making proposals on consumer matters to Scottish ministers and public organisations in Scotland and to other organisations where needed. Consumer Scotland have now been up and running since July, carrying out a wide range of activities, influencing and adding value where it is needed most. For example, in relation to water policy, Consumer Scotland is already a key player, campaigning for a fair deal for customers and assisting with policy development. As a member of strategic stakeholder groups, Consumer Scotland scrutinises the delivery of Scottish Water's investment programme to ensure that ministers' objectives are being delivered. I welcome this engagement as an assurance that customers and communities have high-quality representation. Consumer Scotland will also be carrying out their own research to identify the potential impact that future increases in water and sewerage charges may have on low-income households. This legislation is an opportunity for us to ensure that consumers have a voice, that their interests are represented, and that their own capacity to drive change is harnessed. The situation we find ourselves in now regarding the cost crisis has revealed how important it is that customers have access to the information they need and are mindful of the impacts of their own behaviour. We began this process of establishing Consumer Scotland because we recognise that consumers are the lifeblood of our economy, and in the months ahead, consumers will be vital for rebuilding our economy and supporting businesses. We will continue this process, and one of the ways of doing this is for, I hope, for the committee to agree to recommend the approval of the draft regulations. So, Nat, Convener, I will conclude and be happy to take any questions that the committee may have.
Thank you, Minister. Do I have indications of questions? Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, and thank you, Minister. I'm just wondering if you could explain to us if Citizens Advice Scotland are actually losing functions and they're actually transferring, or is it just a copy? Is it a duplication?
The role of Consumer Scotland is set out in the Act, which was passed unanimously at stage three. Its primary role is as Scotland's independent consumer advocate, but Citizens Advice Bureau will still be that first port of call for many people in providing advice. It sits within that broader landscape of consumer support. So there's Consumer Scotland, there's Advice Direct Scotland, there's CAS, and of course there's Trading Standards as well. But the role of Consumer Scotland will be providing that national advocacy as set out in the legislation and helping to work and coordinate a lot of the activity that goes on in Scotland.
So if I as a consumer had an issue with Scottish Water, I could still go to my local Citizens Advice Bureau?
Yeah, this is a role around advocacy. I don't know, Neil, if you maybe want to explain some of the distinction between the two bodies.
One of the things we've been doing in helping Consumer Scotland set up is increase the transparency in terms of where the consumer goes if they need any support and help. And there are other organisations out there who play a role, such as Advice Direct Scotland, as well as ministers mentioned Trading Standards. So, yes, they can still go to the Bureau, they can go to Advice Direct Scotland or Trading Standards. It will probably depend which one they went to on the nature of the issue, but I'm hoping the work we've done to simplify that consumer journey has helped. The other points maybe worth making is the staff who used to undertake the consumer advocacy functions in CAS were to be transferred across to Consumer Scotland in May of this year.
Okay. Citizens Advice, what's their view on this? They've been consulted.
Yes, they have been consulted. As set out in the legislation, there was a requirement to consult with Consumer Scotland and Citizens Advice, and they have been consulted with.
And what was their view?
Well, ultimately, this is about the implementation of the Act that was passed by Parliament. So I think they recognise that this is the decision that Parliament has taken, is to set up an independent body, which is a non-ministerial office, with regards to Consumer Scotland. So we have engaged carefully and listened, and we've worked through that 2P process to ensure that Consumer Scotland is now operational. And as I said, this ultimately completes the journey. It's a technical instrument which is fundamentally about implementing the legislation that Parliament has passed.
Thanks.
Maggie Chapman.
Thank you very much, Convener. And good morning, Minister. Thank you for what you've said so far. And I just to follow up, really, on Graham's questions, I note what you say about the chipping over of staff from CAS to Consumer Scotland and the responsibilities that have shifted. I just wonder if, in the consultation process, Citizens Advice Scotland identified any potential barriers or pitfalls that we should be aware of as we look, especially given the coming months. We know that CAS are going to be very busy. Are there potential pinch points or areas that we need to be alert to?
No. We work very closely with CAS during the process, particularly the Scotland Act orders. Mm-hmm. The Minister mentioned the extra help unit, which sits within CAS, which gives further support to vulnerable consumers in the energy and post-based in particular, and we had a lot of discussions with CAS to actually get that sorted properly, so there were shared responsibilities, particularly in terms of where the extra help unit needed powers. My team wrote to CAS on these instruments, and their chief exec confirmed he was happy with them. And
Okay, thank you.
That's fine. Any other questions? Yeah. Oh, yes, Jamie Harcourt-Johnson.
Yeah, thanks very much. Good morning. But there's also been a lot of change within this sector and area. When will the first performance review be of Consumer Scotland?
I believe that is set out in the legislation as within 5 years, in terms of the review that Consumer Scotland will be expected to undertake of how they've performed. There will also be regular discussions with officials and the Minister to review how they're getting on. And that's part of the joint working that I know the Minister is keen for us to have going forward with all the public bodies.
Yeah, so in terms of kind of public or scrutiny by either this committee or other committees, how will we be able to? Will we see that in the kind of ongoing review rather than the 5 years? Will we know, say, by next year how there's an indication of how things are performing?
The reporting requirements are set out in the legislation, but I would want to stress that this is set up as an NMO, so it's directly accountable to Parliament. Indeed, this committee, as a lead committee in this area in Parliament, can directly engage with Consumer Scotland on these matters. And I'm conscious this has been an NMO, not wanting to overstep my mark as a minister in what I say.
And just the last, I mean, you know, you talked about kind of user pathways, I think, and how. How there are a number of organisations out there, and there is potential, as has been suggested, the risk of duplication or some areas overlapping. Will how clear user pathways are, how clear information is, and who to go to for advice be part of the reviews going forward?
Again, I wouldn't want to get into the territory of commenting specifically on the work programme, the work that Consumer Scotland will undertake. But clearly, as Scotland's independent consumer advocacy body, they can play an important role in helping to work with other stakeholders and work in partnership with others to maximise coherence and accessibility within the overall consumer support landscape. I don't know if there's anything you'd want to add.
Yeah, there's only one extra thing I'd say, but that it's something that came up very strongly in the bill process about coordination between public consumer bodies, and one of the things that we set up in the wake of the pandemic was the Consumer Network for Scotland, which was drawing a lot of those bodies together in one space. Now Consumer Scotland has been established. We have stepped back from that to allow them to take leadership of that group. We set that group up when we did probably at least 18 months earlier than we'd expected, because we needed to capture that information coherently from consumer bodies to understand what the issues consumers were facing from spring 2020 onwards, and feed that into policy decisions across government and elsewhere. And that has been really effective in terms of actually helping a lot of the bodies actually speak more clearly together.
Okay. All right, thanks.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions? Nope. I now invite the Minister to speak to and move the motion S6M05257.
Moved.
Thank you. Does any members wish to speak? Nope. That is a debate. We're not having a debate. I conclude, but I'll put the question on the motion, which is that motion S6M05257 be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Thank the Minister and his officials for joining us this morning, and I'll briefly suspend the meeting while we change the panel of witnesses. Our next item of business this morning is an evidence session as part of committee's pre-budget scrutiny work. The purpose of this session is to inform the committee's pre-budget scrutiny with the aim of influencing the budget before spending priorities for the next financial year are set out. And the focus of today's session is support for women in business, and I refer members to papers 2 and 3, and I welcome Ruth Boyle, Policy and Parliamentary Manager with Close the Gap, and Caroline Curry, Chief Executive of Women's Enterprise Scotland. Thank you for joining us this morning. Could I first ask, as I said, this is about our pre-budget scrutiny, and we did have a statement from the government last week, 2 weeks ago, about proposed changes to the budget. We're expecting a more substantive statement after the recess. I might come to Ruth first of all. I suppose I'd be interested in the views on decisions that were made. I do recognise we're in a very tight financial situation, and the government chose to spend money in areas which will, in some cases, benefit women. The child will payment went up, that's positive. But there was also the £53 million cut to employability services. We did get a letter from the minister that came to the committee just last week that, you know, describes the money as, it is money that would be focused on support for parents. It would restrict being able to employability to bring it up to scale and to enhance the support that's available for parents this year. Do you have, well, I suppose, what... I mean, as I said, I recognise we're in a tight financial situation, but do you have an understanding of what the impact of that might be, and where would you like to see focus within the employability services if we're looking at the statement that's going to come after recess?
Yeah, and thank you so much for inviting Close the Gap to give evidence today. We're really delighted that the committee is looking into women in the economy as part of the pre-budget scrutiny. I think that's a really good indication of where the committee's priorities lie. Firstly, just to cover the budget in general, I think what we need to be mindful of is that budget decisions are not neutral. So when we're making decisions about how we're allocating resources, you have the opportunity to dismantle inequalities or to reinforce them. And that's why it's really important that we're doing gender budgeting analysis in terms of the budgetary decisions that we're making, also having that accompanying gender analysis in terms of being able to understand how different spend is impacting men and women differently based upon their socioeconomic inequalities. I think the question that you ask raised some underlying issues in terms of the transparency of the budget, for example. So when we think about that £53 million cut to employability, it's difficult to completely understand what that means in terms of the delivery, because it's very difficult, as we know, to look at budgets across different years and understand how that spending has been made. In terms of employability in general, if the £53 million is coming from the delivery of the Parental Employability Support Fund, which I think there's maybe been some indication that there would be, that's a fund that Close the Gap have looked at to try and understand what the outcomes have been for parents. It's actually very difficult to see how that money has been spent at the local level. So that money was given to local authorities to deliver in the different ways that they see fit. But because of that, and we've had a look at local authority budget lines, we can't actually see how that money has been spent or how it has delivered outcomes for women. So I think we'd be very interested to know what that will mean if that money is being cut. Is it actually delivering on the ground? And I guess that would indicate how concerned we would be about that. In terms of employability in general, we know that generic employability programmes don't meet women's needs, because they don't take account of women's caring responsibilities, they don't take account of occupational segregation, which is the clustering of men and women into different types and levels of work. So often when we look at job matching within employability, for example, those models are very keen to funnel women into types and jobs of sectors that they're already dominant, and that reinforces women's low-paid work in the economy. So we really need to be making sure that we have these specialised programmes that do deliver for women, particularly women with caring responsibilities and other marginalised groups of women, but also that those mainstream delivery programmes are also taking account of women's needs. And this again comes back to the point that I'm sure we'll be making a lot today around gender mainstreaming and having that data so that we can actually see how programmes are delivering for women. And we know that the mainstream programmes around Fair Start Scotland have had some difficulties in terms of meeting women's needs. There's been a failure to meet the targets in terms of those groups that they really wanted to be able to engage with. So I think if we're losing a specialised programme that was delivering for women and then relying on this mainstream engagement, we would be concerned by that, because we know that that's not yet meeting women's needs. And just to finish off, I think it's really important as we move to the emergency budget review that we are having that robust gender analysis in terms of how we're spending that money. During times of economic crisis, it's really important that we're targeting those resources to get the most out of the spend that the Scottish Government is making. But we don't yet have the data about who's experiencing poverty and how we can tackle that in order to make sure we're doing that effectively. Within the Child Poverty Delivery Plan, we have this priority group model, which we're really supportive of because that allows that targeting of resources. But when we look at the data that we have, we don't yet have the data to demonstrate how that spend is benefiting those groups. Indeed, Audit Scotland's report this week highlighted that an area where we're particularly lacking data is for families who fall into one or more priority groups. And that again comes back to this intersectionality point, so understanding that different groups have different needs and that they might fall into multiple protected characteristics. So I think our takeaways would be better data, making sure we're doing that gender analysis as we move into the next stage of the budget, particularly in this current economic context.
Okay, thank you, Ruth. I think other members will focus more on the issue of data as we go through the session. But maybe if I could ask Carolyn, so the, you know, as I said, we'll have the budget, we'll have more information after the October recess. It is now over 6 months since we had the 10-year economic transformation strategy that was published, and we're waiting on the sectoral reports. They should have come within 6 months. We're waiting on the sectoral reports. I suppose, what are you looking for from the budget and how it will deliver on that 10-year economic strategy? And at the time, there were some questions asked about, did it prioritise women enough? Did it recognise women's businesses? Was there, I think there was some language around supporting women, but maybe a lack of how is that actually going to happen? And I don't know if you've had any discussions with government around the 6 month plans, what your expectation of that is, and how you think the budget is going to support that type of work.
Well, I think in terms of the budget and the opportunity before us, you know, that the current landscape is really clear. Inequality is heightening. So, you know, women are getting a really raw deal. They got a raw deal through the pandemic and we're now in a cost of living crisis. And we are really concerned that inequality is accelerating. And in fact, the point that Ruth made very eloquently around mainstreaming is not changing the status quo. Arguably, it's actually accelerating inequality. On the economic strategy, we were really pleased to see the word women within the strategy. One of the issues we have seen previously is a continued reference to inclusive growth with no definition of what lies behind inclusive growth. So unless we start to dig into what do we mean by inclusive growth, there will be no change. We're not getting data on the subsections of inclusive growth in order to actually address it. In terms of women, what we need is the data that informs us of where we can invest wisely. You know, we know, just talked already about budgets being cut, so we need to be really wise with where we're investing. To do that, we need data. We have a history of investing blind and expecting inequality to be addressed. You know, we invest just expecting mainstream services to target women and all will be well. That isn't working. So we really need to see targeted strategies, investment in women's needs, an understanding of women's needs, and designing and delivering services that are set up to address women's needs. Now, you know, economically, that shouldn't come as a surprise. It's the same for any sector of the economy. We have sectors to help food and drink, we have strategies to help food and drink, for example, and other economic sectors. It is the same for women, but it hasn't yet happened. So what do we want? We want those services and support that are specifically designed for women. We expect those services and support to be delivered by expert organisations, not by the mainstream. And we also expect to see investment in the Women's Business Centre commitment. You know, we've just talked about a £53 million cut. I think it's interesting to understand, well, where is that money going to be invested? And from my perspective, I'm looking for clear insight on where the 50 million and how the 50 million government commitment is going to be invested in a Women's Business Centre model. You know, the problem at the minute, with an economy that is in a state of flux, there's a lack of certainty, businesses procrastinate. You know, I would really urge the government not to procrastinate and to invest now, targetedly invest in what we know is needed and what we know works. We know this model works. We have got the international comparators. We know it is successful. We have got research in its swathes telling us and informing us we need to act. And that is what I would like to see in this budget. Action and strategic delivery for women's services. Too often where women's services have been invested in, they are small, short-term programmes that do not join up. You know, one example of the growing strategic need has been the increase in violence against women during the pandemic. Now, economic abuse is a key element of violence against women, but there is no sustainable strategy that is set up to help women to recover economically and to get on their feet and to develop. So in that sense, having a strategy that helps women out of difficult times, helps them to rebalance, helps them to regain their skills and helps them to progress is incredibly valuable, but it's missing. And we keep on giving crisis funding instead of looking at where we could be much more strategic. And starting up a business, starting up an enterprise is a valuable path out of poverty, out of difficulty and out of poor health situations.
And we've had, I mean, since 2014, that's when the Women's Enterprise Framework and Action Plan came, and then that was refreshed in 2017. At the moment, we're waiting on the Anna Stewart review into women in enterprise. So you're saying everybody knows what needs to be done, but at the moment we're waiting on another review. Has Anna Stewart engaged with you as an organisation, and I think the review is due quite soon. What would you want to see in that review that you think will make a difference? Do you think that is a key document in terms of the government's approach and understanding of this issue?
Well, I do think we've got a good understanding of what the need and the issue is. You know, we welcome reports. You know, reports give you another lens on a particular point in time. This report undoubtedly will do that and will be valuable. But yes, we need to see the report. My sense is we need to take action. If we are delaying action because the report isn't out, every day that we delay has an economic cost. You know, that is the fact of productivity. We're relying on the status quo, which isn't delivering. So we really need to start to take action. I hope the Stewart review will come out soon, as soon as possible, I would urge, if that's the case. You know, we have an economy in a state of flux. Women are, you know, not being well served currently. I think we're all agreed that we want to see equality and we want to see women and children and families, because they're linked, lifted out of poverty. Enterprise is a strong path to do that, and it's imperative that we start to take those actions. And yes, you know, we know pretty much what needs to be done. Our own consultations are pretty consistent. We have 10 years of research and data pointing to the same consistent challenges. Access to finance, access to support that understands women and their ideas, that supports them to progress their ideas, and gives them the confidence to go forward. Instead of, at the minute, our most recent consultation was absolutely clear that women are actively being disencouraged and their confidence is being eroded instead of being supported and progressed.
Okay, thank you. I'm now going to bring in Fiona Hislop, and followed by Michelle Thompson.
So we want to look at the pre-budget scrutiny and we want to put women at the centre. Clearly, I think it's perhaps an understatement to say there's volatility in the economy and the fiscal situation as we speak. So therefore, budgets will be tough. I hear what you're saying about mainstreaming. You want mainstreaming, but you also want targeting. And I think we need to be helpful to get you to unpack that. And I suppose the other question is, and it will be the case that budgets will be tight, what is already there you want to keep because it may be at risk, because everything's going to be looked at? And obviously, ideally, everybody wants more money, but that's going to be a challenge. But what would your priorities be? So I think that thing is, what is already happening that you would say that's a priority to keep? And can you explain that kind of a wee bit more in that mainstreaming, but also targeting, because there's a bit of a contradiction there.
Well, we need to keep business start-up services. That's a priority. So, you know, the gateway services that we have, we absolutely need to keep that. That's what I would refer to as mainstream, if you like. There's no cost to access it. It's available across Scotland. It's easily accessible. It's absolutely imperative that we keep that. So that should not be confused with where we see the gaps in the mainstream service. So our research will tell us there are gaps. If you look at the end-to-end business support from pre-stage, when you're considering an idea, right the way through to scale and exit, you know, some of the services work okay for women. They're progressing. Others are extremely leaky. So we would be looking to put in women-specific support at the very early stage of idea creation, because we know that that will then strengthen those ideas. We'll see businesses coming through in areas where there is no access to the economy and there is no economic contribution currently, and we've run programmes and pilots that have evidenced that. So we'd like to see that specific targeted support at that very early stage. We'd also like to see some levels of support in the early stage start-up services. You know, Gateway does a good job of getting over some of the basics, some of the information. We've got it all in one particular portal. The access is better than it used to be. The landscape is slightly less cluttered. But nonetheless, for women, it is absolutely imperative that they get the support that they need in an environment that makes them feel valued with their ideas and makes them feel confident about progressing. So, you know, we would say that that's where a women's business centre model comes in, a place where women can go, where they can be together, where they can discuss their ideas with like-minded people, where they can gain the support and the extra skills and knowledge that they do not have as individuals to strengthen their business idea, to add resilience to that, and to then go forward. So in that start-up phase, it's a case of complementing some of the gateway services. Now, we do that already. We've got the digital portal, the womensbusinesscentre.com. That worked well during the pandemic. But we need a physical place where women can go, where they can go to be together, to network. I think we all know digital has its positives, it absolutely does, but there is nothing like getting together with your peers to discuss it, or getting that one-on-one expert face support or coaching or mentoring that can make all the difference to strengthening your opportunities with your business and to you as an individual, and feeling you have the capability to actually do it. So we'd look for support there. And then the other area that we see as a gap is the pipeline between Business Gateway and the enterprise agencies. So that is incredibly difficult for women to come through. The agencies are looking at traditional economic sectors, as Ruth has already said. Women tend not to be in the sectors that we may categorise as the growth sectors. The agencies operate on a growth sector model in terms of access. So we see a need to put in women-specific support there to ensure that businesses come through that pipeline, that they don't just establish and leak out. That's what the data tells us. The data tells us we are seeing phenomenal rates of women starting up businesses, but they're leaking out. They're not coming through that pipeline to then continue to establish and grow. So we see putting support in there as, you know, really very important, particularly support around leadership, around strategic development, around assessing, you know, your first year or so in business, and then looking at what you need to do from your learnings and your insight in order to sustain that growth and keep that momentum. So there's intervention needed there, and we would urge that to be women specific.
So that's extremely helpful. Would it be reasonable to say that what we need to be pressing the government on is to get better value for the public purse, which is also, you know, in terms of women's contributions as well, that actually that's a good economic argument, because the benefits of having more women being successful will have a disproportionate impact on tackling inequality, so that regarding a tight budget, that actually in itself will provide value from existing budgets.
Yes, I mean, there's an argument that says in some cases you'll be transferring people who are reliant on the public purse to actually contributing to that public purse. So there's a double benefit in there, and that is undoubtedly the case. There is, I don't think we've got enough time today, there is a real issue with procurement. There is a real issue in terms of how services are invested in and procured. You know, I've mentioned already mainstream delivery, the way that procurement works. Much of the service provision is delivered by large mainstreaming organisations who are good at mainstreaming. That's what they do. They mainstream, they're generalists. We are speaking here about the development of specialist services. The people best placed to deliver that are specialist organisations. That's where you get value for money. That's where you would expect an uplift. I mean, it's pretty much economic common sense, I think, in that case. But we're not seeing that coming through. We're not seeing that being funded. We are not seeing that coming through the current procurement structures. There are many layers of structural inequality within procurement. And I would certainly urge the committee, please, to address that. This isn't just about where we invest. It is about how we invest and how we ensure we deliver the impact that we all want to see coming through.
That's very clear. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Michelle Thompson, followed by Maggie Chapman.
Good morning. I mean, you've already touched on so many different areas. I'll ask one kind of open question just now, and I may want to come back in. We also had in gender, I'm on the finance committee yesterday, and they gave evidence for the budget as well, and they said concerns regarding the lack of attention the Scottish budget process pays to structural gender equality. And I suppose what my question is, I mean, you've talked about data, you've talked about outcomes, you've given some specifics, but in terms of how does our Scottish budget process move beyond to having regard to systemic barriers for women and take the bold steps needed to affect real change? You're here today, so I suppose the question is, have you been to every other committee to give similar evidence aligned to them, given the cross-cutting issues that you've started to outline? Have you given evidence to every other committee? Have indeed you been invited to? And so what comment could you give about the actual process? That would be useful as well. Thank you.
I'm happy to take that first. This is the only committee that Close the Gap are giving evidence on in terms of pre-budget scrutiny. I will be fair to the Parliament and say that we tend not to engage as vigorously on the budget as some other women's organisations. So we would expect Scottish Women's Budget Group and Engender to be appearing at more committees in terms of actually giving that gendered evidence. For us, in terms of the process, often equalities organisations get very narrowly focused in terms of parliamentary engagement just with the Equalities Committee, but actually that needs to be mainstreamed across all of the committees. Also, when it comes to the budget scrutiny, it's seen as the priority for the Equality Committee to look at how the budget is delivering equality, but actually that should be a priority for every single committee, including the Finance Committee. In terms of improving that budget process, we would point to the recommendations that came from the Equality Budgetary Advisory Group, EBAG. Those actions could become a ready-made action plan in terms of how we actually improve that budget process. But I think it comes back to this point about leadership and prioritisation, and it's down to all MSPs and all committees to actually prioritise that process in terms of thinking about how that spend is delivering for women. And until we get that kind of collective responsibility for prioritising equality, I think we're going to be quite limited in how we're able to progress that. And we know that this is a time where it's particularly important that we're thinking about those structural inequalities. If we look at the COVID crisis and also the cost of living crisis, that really illuminated the fact that structural inequalities remain rife in Scotland, and we have an opportunity to actually do something about that. I think as well, just to pick up on the previous point about the way that we think about gender equality. So often gender equality is seen as being a cost to the taxpayer or a cost to the purse. But actually that should be seen as an opportunity for economic growth. analysis from Close the Gap found that if we close the gender gap in employment, that's worth £17 billion to the Scottish economy. And we know there's an increasing evidence base that gender equality is good for economic growth, but the reverse isn't necessarily true. So we can't just presume that economic growth is going to solve these structural inequalities, because we have decades of evidence that's shown that that's not the case. Similarly, in terms of thinking about the things that we need to maintain, we would be really adamant that an area where we still need investment is the childcare sector. And there's a really strong return on investment from investing in childcare, because it enables women to enter the labour market or to increase their working hours. We see during the cost of living crisis that there's a sense that individuals can just increase their working hours in order to increase their earnings. But that ignores those gendered barriers that women experience, because they're more likely to be primary caregivers or to have wider caring responsibilities for older people or disabled people. And there was research done by the Centre for Progressive Policy, and it showed that across the UK, if women had access to adequate childcare that enabled them to work the hours that they wanted, that could generate £28 billion in economic output. So I think it's about also shifting the way that we view gender equality, and rather than seeing it being as something that you do when the times are good, it's something that needs to be embedded in every policy decision that we're undertaking, in every budgetary decision, because it's going to be good for the wider economy. Yes, I think I'll leave it there for now.
And before I bring Caroline in, I mean, you're really, in essence, utterly reframing this as an economic problem to be solved rather than pigeonholed as an equalities problem, and I think that comes through quite clearly. Caroline, you get in to add?
Yes.
I'm sure you have.
So it is absolutely an economic problem to be solved, and I think we are all good at wanting to see greater equality. You know, we all want that to happen, and we all talk about that, and it's part of the economic strategy for transformation, rightly so. But where we are very poor is reminding ourselves that the same old processes therefore need to be changed and adapted. And so, to answer your question, no, this is the only committee I've been asked to give evidence. And that in itself, I think, is a fairly damning indictment of the process itself. Although, in fairness, as an organisation, we actually struggle to resource as much engagement as we would like. One of the impacts for us during the pandemic was we were fortunate enough to secure emergency funding so that we could transform our model and keep going and provide our support. But the one element of our application that was declined was request to support a policy manager role. So we are now operating, arguably, at the greatest time of need to engage, as inequality is heightening, with one arm behind our back, because I have no policy manager resource. So, you know, things like today are done pro bono, bluntly. You know, that's what we're relying on. And that isn't good. That doesn't help anybody. And so we need to get better at the processes that we are implementing, at holding ourselves to account, at having dashboards and measures that make sure we remind ourselves what is it, you know, what is the equality impact with this policy? What is the equality impact with these plans? And to do that, processes need to be changed. Dashboards and data and accounting systems, I don't mean accounting systems, I mean systems that hold us to account and remind us, are in place to ensure that that is what happens.
I'll just ask one more question and then I'll let other people in, because I know people want to come in. I suppose conditionality is something that we've not talked all that much about yet, but it leads naturally on from data collection. If there is one or a few things that you would recommend about conditionality, assuming that the data is in place, which is a whole separate discussion, what specifically would you recommend in terms of the budget around conditionality? Or your top three, because there's quite a lot, I suspect.
Do you mean in terms of...
Well, if you were really going to affect change, you could say, for example, that no public body should award any grant funding unless it is entirely equitable. It's more complex than that because we know that women may not apply for grants, for example, and that's a cultural barrier. But that's a very simple example. But it's about really affecting change, which goes back to the point about systemic. So if conditionality, I mean, if I were a budget holder, I may be inclined to do that, particularly for women in business, because tinkering thus far, whilst very well-meaning, because this is complex, I understand that, but maybe we need to be bolder. So if you were to, if you were in charge, what would you be doing about allocation of funding?
Well, I would leave it up to Carolyn to talk about for women-led businesses, but with a focus thinking about women across the labour market, we know that procurement could and should be doing more in terms of tackling the undervaluation of women's work. So we procure a large amount of services in sectors such as childcare and social care, where women's work is vastly undervalued and underpaid. And these were women who were critical to a successful pandemic response, and we saw something of a societal shift in terms of how we talked about these roles. But in terms of the long-term tangible benefits to those women of that societal shift, we've not really seen anything yet because their work remains underpaid, undervalued and underprotected. So when we think about the Fair Work First criteria and thinking about that in the sense of procuring public services, there could be more in terms of paying the real living wage. The Scottish Government have committed to paying childcare staff who are delivering the 11.40 hours the living wage, and that's a really great start, but we would like to see that going further so that all childcare staff are being paid the living wage regardless of the hours that they're delivering. Similarly, when we think about the National Care Service, there's going to be real opportunities there to embed Fair Work in that system and in the procurement for those services. So I think there would be definitely things around procurement that we could be doing. If I'm going to give you three, I would say around gender pay gap reporting for the organisations who are being who are procuring services, but also making sure that it's not just about reporting that figure, but that those organisations actually have to take change and make action to tackle that gender pay gap. We see that as the flaw with the UK government's gender pay gap legislation, that pay transparency is a good start, but because it doesn't require organisations to take action on their gender pay gap, they aren't bothering to do so. So gender pay gap reporting, the real living wage, and also thinking about the security of the work as well, because we know that women's work in sectors where they're undervalued is becoming increasingly precarious, which has gendered implications in terms of their financial security, which reduces their financial resilience during times that we're currently seeing where we're in a period of economic crisis. So that would be my long-winded way of getting to three.
Okay.
Well, I think conditionality is a brilliant tool that is potentially underused, and I think we've seen it used really well, for example, in the field of Fair Work. You know, if you are applying for a government grant, conditionality in terms of Fair Work is one of those requirements. And we've certainly seen that working well to drive change. So we would certainly welcome greater use of conditionality to drive much greater equality. In terms of procurement itself, I would love to see conditionality in procurement, that where you are effectively procuring for expert services, for services for women, that is a condition of that procurement, the expert organisations are given the opportunity to apply and the system values their expertise, and we do not end up simply procuring the lowest common denominator in support, and then we're surprised that there's no impact in terms of the delivery. In terms of how procurement itself could have conditionality within it, we would certainly like to see where we're procuring for women, that organisations that are taking that procurement have a fair and equal representation. And it's very easy for organisations and procurement to say, look, here are some women in the organisation. And that's good, and that, you know, helps to drive gender balanced teams. We know that helps with driving innovation and productivity. We know that's good for the economy. That is a good step. It is only a good first step. What is really important if we're wanting to see change is we need to see organisations coming through that have a gender balanced leadership and ownership. These are the two areas where I would really like to see conditionality applied. You know, all too often we see organisations where we're saying, look, you know, it's good, we've got a bit of gender balance, there's a woman or two in the leadership. But really, we need to see the people that have power, that are taking the decisions. That's where we need to see the gender balance, because that's where the change actually happens within those organisations, and that's where they can take the decisions that will ensure they are delivering top quality services and they are pulling from the advantages of equality and diversity. They are having the diverse teams, the diverse ownership, the diverse thinking in terms of decision making that we know drives innovative thinking, the type that brings in new, novel, competitive ways of doing things and improves our economy. You know, that is investing wisely, because that is putting resilience into the delivery organisations and the delivery structure.
Thank you.
So we would welcome that tomorrow, please.
Thank you. I'll now invite Maggie Chapman to be followed by Jamie Hawker-Johnson.
Thanks very much, Claire. And thank you. Good morning, both. Thank you for what you've said so far. You've covered an awful lot. And I'm very aware that what we're actually trying to unpick here are decades of structural and systemic inequalities in all of our structures. You've mentioned procurement, but even the way we think about the economy as a whole, they're clearly very deeply embedded inequalities in that. And as Michelle said, and you both referred to, expecting the same old to deliver change by just throwing money at it is blind, I think was one of the words you used, Carolyn. I suppose given the context that we're in now, facing a cost crisis, cost of living crisis, cost of doing business crisis, if we compare or if we look at how we were able to respond and the benefits and problems that came with that to the COVID crisis a few years ago, there's been that cultural shift that you've referred to in how we have revalued some of women's work and some of the priorities that we give that. Carolyn, you talked about things like the digital portal working well, but during COVID, a very, very clear increase in violence against women around economic abuse and control. And I'm wondering what are the lessons that we can learn from both the policy and cultural responses to COVID that to inform our decision making now? And what are the consequences? What are the potential impacts on women in the workplace, women-owned businesses, if we get it wrong? And I suppose specifically in this immediate budget, but thinking as Claire has mentioned, you know, the longer term economic strategies that we're talking about. I don't know which of you wants to go first.
Ruth, go first. I think that's a really good question. And I'm Close the Gap alongside Engender had done a lot of thinking about how we facilitate a gender sensitive economic recovery in the aftermath of COVID. Obviously did not expect to be hurling straight from that crisis directly into a cost of living crisis. And there's almost not been enough time for the dust to settle in terms of learning those lessons. But you're right that during this period of crisis, it's really important that we're looking at what happened during COVID and ensuring that we're doing things better. And I think for us, when we look at the response to the COVID-19 crisis, it illuminated things that we knew already in terms of that lack of data and the lack of gender mainstreaming. Even governments who have an expressed commitment to gender equality often deprioritise that during times of economic crisis, because it's seen as secondary to that crisis response rather than something that you should be embedding. And if we look back to the response to COVID, we see that the quality of equality impact assessments deteriorated even further. And I think that would be quite shocking for equalities organisations to think that that was possible, because they're not done particularly well from the outset. But we saw them being completed to an increasingly poor standard, also significantly too late in the policy process. So the point of an equality impact assessment is that you're doing that at the earliest possible point so you can make changes to that policy. Often there would be a policy passed, legislation passed in Parliament, and the equality impact assessment would arrive 2 weeks later. And that's far too late in the process to actually influence that policy. So we definitely saw that deprioritisation of equalities work, and we saw the impact of that in terms of the response to that crisis not being well gendered. If we look at a UK government example, for example, the introduction of the furlough scheme from the outset that didn't meet women's needs because there was no clause that you could be furloughed for caring responsibilities, for example, and that came much later. Whereas if you'd done that equality impact assessment from the outset, that was something you could have embedded in that policy. So I think learning the lessons that deprioritising gender equality means that your policies will not meet women's needs is really important. The other thing was around data. So we did a lot of work on the impact of the pandemic on women's employment, but we were really hindered in that by the lack of data in terms of actually being able to demonstrate those things. There were some data around the furlough scheme, but that wasn't intersectional. So there's still no way of determining, for example, how many Black and minority ethnic women were furloughed or how disabled women experienced furlough. So we can't deprioritise the work on improving data as well. So I think that's another really important lesson that we have in terms of if we get it wrong in the cost of living crisis, what the impact will be for women. We know that poverty in Scotland is gendered, so women are already more likely to be experiencing poverty, more likely to experience in-work poverty, and also find it harder to escape poverty. What we see both in COVID and in the cost of living crisis is that women are being disproportionately impacted because of their pre-existing inequality in society. So we know in the cost of living crisis that women are the majority of low-paid workers and are already more likely to be experiencing poverty. As I mentioned, they face gendered barriers to increasing their working hours and their earnings in order to respond to this crisis. Women also have lower levels of savings and wealth than men and are more likely to be in debt, which again reduces their financial resilience. Women are twice as likely to be reliant on social security, and also women still function as poverty managers in the home. So it's often women's responsibility to make household budgets stretch. And that means that they feel the physical health and the mental health implications much more acutely during the cost of living crisis. And some forthcoming research from Scottish Women's Budget Group has shown that women are already skipping meals in order to feed their children, even women with pre-existing health conditions, where that's going to have a really detrimental effect to their long-term health. So if we get this wrong, what we'll be doing is further embedding women's inequality. We will be pushing women who are already under enormous financial pressure really to the brink. And also because of those inextricable links between women's poverty and child poverty, if we push women into further poverty as a result of the cost of living crisis, it's almost impossible to see how Scotland will meet their child poverty targets, because we know that action to improve women's equality in the labour market, to increase their earnings, is critical if we're actually to address child poverty. So I think the stakes are really high, and it's really important. And I think your question is a really great one, because we do need to look back to that previous crisis in order to understand how we can do things better.
Thanks, Ruth. That's very clear. And I think the response doesn't seem to be mobilising in the same way as it did around COVID for any of the next few months. And I find that quite concerning. Yeah. Carolyn, do you want to?
Yeah, I think it's extremely concerning. We are undoubtedly in a crisis of inequality. We're talking about a cost of living crisis. The debate that is not being had is the crisis of inequality that we're facing. In terms of what we can learn from COVID, when the pandemic first hit, we were part of, the UK... Let me get this. UK Women's Enterprise Policy Group. I think that's right. You get the gist anyway. So a group of UK organisations, and we came together during the pandemic to lobby government together. And what we said right at the start was, if you do not cast a gendered lens over your policies and over the emergency support that is going out, then women are going to be coming off worse. You are not going to help equality. In fact, you're going to drive inequality. And so we said that right at the start, get a gender lens over what you're doing as soon as you can, be cognizant of the issue. That didn't happen. And what we have seen is women's equality heightening, exactly as we had feared. So, you know, you may well remember when I gave evidence last year, we had just completed analysis of two of the COVID-19 business relief grant funds, two key funds that were put out there to help businesses during the pandemic. And our analysis showed that women-led companies received less than 11% of those capital funds. So, you know, clear evidence that women are not receiving their fair share of support. Now, that in itself is concerning, but when you think of the construct of women-owned businesses, they are, you know, much smaller than male-led businesses. They're about 44% of the size of male-led businesses. They are highly vulnerable. They were in the pandemic. They were often amongst the first businesses to close and the last to reopen. Mm. So they have been highly vulnerable and hard hit by the pandemic. We are now going into another crisis, and these businesses are worse off than they were before and have an even, it's impossible to believe, an even heightened vulnerability to the cost of living crisis that we're seeing. And I'm just looking, I've got some statistics from research that we've done. So in a 2021 survey that we ran, 89% of respondents said that COVID had had a negative impact on them and their business. We did a follow-up survey in June of this year. 41% reported that they and their business income were still negatively impacted by COVID, and almost 30% said that their income was a lot lower. In terms of, you know, Ruth has mentioned that the really serious health impacts, and you know, really quickly, in terms of mental health from this survey we ran in this year, 44% are saying that COVID is still having a negative impact on their mental health. 48% are saying it is still having a negative impact on their physical health. That is not a good foundation for economic growth and to nurture and to see women's business ownership and equality thrive. And we really desperately need to learn from what happened during the pandemic to get a gendered lens over our policies and to target women and women's enterprise support with the help and support that is needed to help these organisations boost their resilience and to get through the cost of living crisis. Otherwise, we are going to see what the statistics have already told us are happening. We'll see more women starting up in business because they have no other option, and they're going to leak straight back out again. And that in itself is a problem. But these are people who may never, never consider enterprise again. Their families may never, never consider enterprise again. And that is not good for our economy. We need to be supporting and nurturing that along through this crisis.
Thanks. I'll leave it there, Claire.
Thank you. Jamie Harpo-Johnson will be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks very much. Good morning. I actually wanted to ask a little bit about rurality and some remote kind of areas, but as ever with these very interesting and concerning kind of sessions and evidence being given, there's lots else that comes up. So I just had a couple of other very quick questions, if that's all right. If there was an annual report or a biannual report that looked at the areas of most concern to you, whether that's equality or access to gendered support or access to procurement specific. You've talked a lot about the data. Would the data be there to produce that? And would it be accurate? Or are we simply in a situation that we just don't know the wider picture?
It's not there.
Right.
The data isn't there. It is astonishing that there is such a lack of data. You know, in order for us to do the grant analysis, we had to buddy up with an external company who has those data feeds to get them from Companies House so we could do a gendered analysis. So the data is not there publicly available. And that, to me, is utterly appalling because we mentioned back at the start the Women's Enterprise Framework, the strategic framework, was refreshed in 2017. The key change there was to add in the need for gender disaggregated data. 5 years on, the data remains pretty much the same, and it is appalling. Now, part of that is because of the feeds that come from UK government, so it isn't just something that is under our control. But we are not investing in data production, and that is a serious problem for our economy. If we have no data, we have no insight to inform us and make us confident about our investment choices, that they are choices that will ultimately drive change. So we wouldn't be, we'd be able to provide some report. I would welcome a report based on available data, because actually it would show us what the status quo is, we could identify the gaps and we could work together to then build an improvement. But actually, a report would give us a start point. We desperately need a start point and we desperately need to establish what data tells us and therefore where we can invest wisely currently and build on that picture for the future.
And just before I come to you, Ruth, if that's all right, we've just seen the Scottish Government appoint a chief entrepreneurial officer or chief entrepreneur at a considerable remuneration. You're struggling to get somebody who does the policy side. Who is the person within Scottish Government, not a ministerial cabinet secretary level, but within the Scottish Government that is there really to push women-led businesses, women-owned businesses, women in the workplace? Who is the most kind of senior person there doing that? Is there somebody specific?
No, there isn't. I really welcome the appointment of a chief entrepreneur. I'm delighted to see an economic strategy that is going to be founded on entrepreneurship. We all know small businesses are the backbone of our communities and they are vital, particularly in a rural context, to economic regeneration. So I would absolutely be delighted to see somebody appointed with that remit, and in fact it would be a great response to some of the issues we've already talked about in terms of that lack of consistency across committees and ensuring that lens is in sight. And in fact it is a well-used tactic. You know, many organisations at board level, I used to work for a large bank, and at board level I had a champion that was responsible for equality and for the initiative I ran, which was Women in Business, and that ensured there was an accountability and a laser-like focus through the organisation. It's very successful.
I will come on to hand with Ruth.
Just on the labour market data point, we know that there is more data that's just not being analysed. So I think we could definitely, from pre-existing data gathering, improve some of the data that relates to women's experiences of the labour market. The intersectionality point, that data is not currently being gathered, so that would be something that would have to be established. The Scottish Government are currently consulting on the equality evidence strategy. From a labour market perspective, we're disappointed in the draft strategy. There's no action within that to improve the range of gender-sensitive, sex-disaggregated data that's being gathered. So I think that's something that in our response we'll be calling for that to be strengthened. The other area of that strategy where we see a key gap is around skills. We really need to understand how our upskilling and reskilling initiatives are delivering for women, particularly at a time when we know that women's jobs are likely to decline in sectors such as retail because of things like automation and the rise of online retail. And then the jobs where roles are expected to increase, like green sectors, we know women are currently underrepresented. So ensuring that upskilling and reskilling is working for women is really critical. And in order to do that, we need data. But within the draft equality evidence strategy, there's no reference to skills data at all. And we know that Skills Development Scotland already gather more equalities data than they publish. So we think there's a clear ask there from the Scottish Government to these delivery agencies to actually be utilising the range of equalities data that they have at their fingertips. And again, the equality evidence strategy is very much aware of the resource context, but that would come at a very low cost since a lot of this is already being done anyway. So I think there's a lot more work to be done in terms of us having the range of data that we would like to see on the labour market and skills.
Okay, I better be very quick to my main kind of point, which is about Highlands and Islands and remote rural areas, and I think skills will probably be part of that. What are the kind of particular challenges that businesses face and people looking for start-up businesses face within those areas? And we've talked about, and I don't want to focus because I know others are going to talk about the business centre, but obviously that would be a central location. How do we make sure the experience and the expertise there can be available to people across areas like mine? And Caroline first then.
Well, actually, interestingly, one of the islands is interested in using one of their buildings as potentially a women's business centre. So, you know, we speak offline perhaps about that, but we are very cognisant that it shouldn't just be one central location. It should be a bit of a hub and spoke model. To get the maximum impact. So it's important to say that, not one central building, but just the start of a wider strategy. So we have done a fair bit of work with women based in remote rural locations. Enterprise, as you'll know, is a key route into employment because often people who have migrated there and are staying there have skills that don't match with the local economy. So starting up a business is really important. the issues that they face, crisis of confidence. Many people haven't started a business before. They don't know where to go. They don't know where to start. If you have a bad experience, or if you feel that perhaps the official looking business gateway doesn't look like it's there for people like you, they're just not going to engage in the first place. So that's really the point I was trying to make about that pre-start support. It is critical for rural areas to nurture those germs of entrepreneurship, often women that have got great ideas. That's what we saw coming through our programmes. We actually saw about 70% of businesses that came through a 10-week startup programme, 70% of participants started a business. When they came through just a short programme, it has given people the confidence and self-belief that they can do it. And, you know, our mainstream agencies are great. They just don't serve everybody's individual needs. And women, as a critical mass, justify economically an investment in their support. So particularly at start-up with confidence, but also with access perhaps to skills that they don't have. So for example, building e-commerce platforms. You know, many people will know they can sell, they can maybe only sell limited amounts within their immediate area, but with an understanding of e-commerce and distribution, suddenly their product could have a much wider appeal. That is something we have really worked on. I think I mentioned before, we've run some e-commerce training that was phenomenally well received. We've seen a bit of an uplift from that. We want to try to keep that going. That's one of the values of a digital platform as well, because women engage digitally. They're much more digital literate than they were at the start of the pandemic. Yeah, and we could really harness it. But it's crucial. It's crucial for rural economies. Yeah. And again, it's that injection of diversity that suddenly sees that ecosystem and that landscape transform and have much more innovation capability, because the diverse thinking and experiences are being injected into it to strengthen it.
Thank you.
And sorry to interrupt, we do have to make some progress. I have allowed members to ask a few questions, but if possible, I'll move on to the next question. Maybe if we have time at the end, we can come back. So Gordon MacDonald will be followed by Colin Smith. And can I ask members and witnesses to keep answers as short and concise as possible?
Okay, thanks very much, convener. And morning. I wanted to ask about grant funding. Caroline, you carried out some research into the pandemic funding, and you highlighted that the hospitality hardship fund was 16% women-led businesses and the resilience fund was 10%. But just for clarity, do you have the percentages for those two funds that relate to businesses equally led by men and women?
So we only pulled the data. We only pulled the data for majority women-led companies. Mm-hmm. Potentially, the data would be there and accessible, but it was a private company we worked with. Mm. Their pro bono bit of support for us, if you like, you know, their CSR strategy, for which we were really grateful. So the data is there and it's possible to access it.
Okay.
But we only looked at that one feed. Back to our resource question.
Right. Okay, thanks very much. My next question is the percentages that you've highlighted about this pandemic funding, is that reflective of the wider grant funding that's available for women-led businesses? I'm thinking of self-employed income support scheme, or indeed the grants that are issued by Scottish Enterprise?
It goes back to where we can access the data. So we do know from some of the analysis of the self-employed income support scheme that more women were entitled to that support than actually received it. So there was a disconnect, I think. You know, so the percentages of men that were entitled to it and received it and applied for it were much higher. Right. Than the percentages of women that were entitled to it and received it and you know, applied it. And we see that coming through with the businesses that we support. You know, many women simply did not know how to access that support. They did not know that it was for businesses like them. They had no awareness because, you know, a proportion of them are still not engaging with our formal enterprise support structure, and therefore they found themselves wholly disconnected. And we did a lot of work informing, reaching out, contacting women. So that certainly, you know, that data reflected our experiences on the ground.
Was part of the problem the lack of targeting to areas where women substantially have businesses. You know, looking at UK numbers, a lot of female businesses is in health, education or hospitality. But was there enough targeting of funding towards those areas, or was it the fact that you've just highlighted that a lot of women weren't aware that the funding was available?
I think, to be fair, it's mostly a lack of awareness, you know, which comes back really to the fundamental issues in the way the system operates. You know, it doesn't engage with everybody. It doesn't engage with some people in the community. And I guess comes back to the point I was making about mainstreaming. You know, mainstreaming does what it's supposed to do. It works with a critical majority. In this case, the critical majority in business are men. It doesn't work so well for women, and therefore they leak out of that system. Hence our argument that we should have specific services which would stop that leakage and, you know, ensure that women are better able to access funding and grants like that.
OK. Ruth, have you got anything you want to add?
No, I don't think so. We did. I was desperately trying to find my phone in my bag there to check a stat, but I was unable to do so. But we did some analysis during COVID looking at the access to the furlough scheme and also the self-employed income support scheme. And I think it really highlighted the points that Carolyn's made today around the respective sizes of men and women's businesses as well, because if you did an analysis of the amount of money that male-led businesses and female-led businesses were getting, you could see that men were getting the most valuable grants because that reflected the sizes of their businesses. So I think, again, that scheme highlighted some of the pre-existing structural issues that we know exist around women's enterprise.
I've got one aside question I was wanting to ask, and it relates to Jamie's questions about rurality. I was looking through the GEM report for Scotland, and it highlighted that in Highlands and Islands, female startups actually were higher than men's startups. And I'm just wondering, was that because, as you made a point earlier, there was no alternative, or is there something else happening in the Highlands and Islands that we have to reflect upon?
Well, traditionally, the Highlands and Islands are very entrepreneurial as communities. They are entrepreneurial out of necessity, really. So there is an argument that says part of that will be driven by a background in entrepreneurship, by knowing family members, by knowing people in your network that have, you know, successfully entered entrepreneurship as a source to make a living and as a career. However, you know, what we know is, for all the reasons statistics have talked about, that women turn to entrepreneurship out of sheer necessity. And therefore, the problem is that we don't necessarily have the systems and support in place to ensure that they endure. So, you know, the GEM report, I think, talks about that in the context, yes, of startups and early stage activity, which is great to see. That's an important part of entrepreneurship. But where we are failing is to keep that momentum going, because it is not translating, it certainly didn't in GEM, into the evidence of established businesses and activity. And again, the statistics we would quote would say, no, that's, it drops off a cliff. So we're just not seeing that early stage desire to start a business and those dreams and aspirations transposing into establishing and then being able to make that economic contribution successfully.
OK, thanks very much.
Yeah, thank you. Colin Smith will be followed by Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to Ruth and Carolyn. Can I briefly return to an issue you both mentioned quite a few times, so it's clearly an important issue, and that's obviously data. Anna Stewart said she's committed to focusing on robust and resilient data, which can be used to benchmark in the coming years as part of the Women in Enterprise Review. Now, you've touched on a number of the gaps in the data already. What are the reasons why we don't gather that data at the moment? Is it just a case of we've never gathered it, or are there particular difficulties in gathering the data that you want to see? And are there any other gaps you haven't mentioned already?
I think it's partly its IBEAN. You know, the system has always reported and used particular sets of data. I just don't think there is a process and a lens in place that says where's the gender disaggregated reporting for this. You know, I think as Ruth has already said, there are some quick wins potentially in the system where the data is there, but nobody is actually casting a gender disaggregated lens over that data to look at the insights from that perspective. And then there are other situations where the data is just wholly absent because we're not collecting it in the first place.
So where are those gaps in Cameron? You mentioned a couple already in reply to Jamie. Where would you see the gaps are though in that data?
The gaps in data. Well, you know, we're relying on GEM, for example, to tell us, you know, where's the split, what are the start-up rates, what regions are doing well. Are they doing well out of necessity? What is happening behind that, for example? So, you know, there's an example of where data and insight would be really helpful. Where are the regions where female entrepreneurship is thriving and where is it not? Which areas or sectors are seeing good start-up rates and are managing to sustain those start-up rates through to established businesses? Is that happening in particular geographic areas? Is it happening in particular sectors? We could get valuable learnings and insights into best practice from that data that could then be, you know, applied out in the broader sense. And I think there's also an argument for saying it would be really helpful to look at urban-based data versus rural-based data and again look at where are the successes within that and you know, where are the best practices that could be applied? And all of that, I think, would help us to invest wisely and to tease out the policies and the practices that are actually making a difference at the minute, but also to bin the policies and practices that aren't working or that need to be adjusted and changed and to be able to identify that. And also at the other end of the spectrum, I think, being able to find out where are the women that are just quietly getting on with establishing and delivering amazing businesses, but they're not on anybody's radar. They're not coming through. They're not visible to the enterprise agencies. Where is the data that shows us where women role models are doing amazing things? Again, we can harness their expertise. We can use them as sources of inspiration, because inspiration is a crucial tool in times like this. You know, we run a role model project. We have 70 women-owned businesses based in different sectors and different locations across Scotland. That makes a phenomenal difference. We try to get their stories into the media so people are aware, and understanding where all these women are and promoting their stories is absolutely crucial to inspiring the next generation to come through and to help with mentoring and coaching.
Thank you. Mr. Smith, anything else you want to ask? Or?
No, I think that's spot on. Thank you very much for that.
Thank you. I might just ask Ruth, so this committee have asked witnesses previously if they do gender disaggregation, whether it's large organisations or businesses, or so that is another part of the picture. Do you find that that is happening to the extent we'd want to see it happening, or how have organisations and businesses engaged with that agenda? Do you have a view on that?
I don't think that they've been engaging with it to the extent that we would want them to. We do some analysis of the reporting under the public sector equality duty, and that requires public bodies to gather data, for example, on their employees. We see that that's done very poorly, and it's not consistent. So I think even when it's a legal requirement, we don't see that being consistently done, which kind of testament to the fact that it's not being prioritised. And there have been a couple of plans lately that have highlighted some actions around data, but we're not seeing those being prioritised. So, for example, in the Gender Pay Gap Action Plan, there was an action to improve the gender disaggregated data on beneficiaries to the Flexible Workforce Development Fund. There's no clarity in terms of how that's been progressed since that plan has been published. Similarly, the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plan had an action to gather gender disaggregated data on beneficiaries beneficiaries of all skills programmes developed to support the transition to green jobs. Again, it's unclear how that's been progressed since that plan was published. And finally, the example I would use is the Tackling Child Poverty Delivery Plan. The previous plan highlighted an action to remove our reliance on household-level statistics to be able to measure women's poverty better. Again, there's not been much progress on that. So I think what we see is data not being prioritised. And I think another issue that I would raise in terms of the way that public bodies and employers are responding to this, we're increasingly seeing organisations using GDPR as a rationale for not gathering equalities data, despite the fact that this could fall under legitimate use. And I think that's something that we would urge the Scottish Government to provide clarity on, particularly for public bodies, so that that can no longer be used as an excuse. So in particular, that's been utilised for not gathering data, for example, on caring responsibilities when you're doing skills programmes, despite the fact that that data is really critical to understanding women's experiences. So again, as part of that equality evidence strategy, I think it would be really positive if there was guidance around GDPR.
Thank you. Graham Simpson to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Yeah, thanks very much. It's been fascinating to listen to you, and I'm really impressed by your enthusiasm for the subject. Caroline, you said that women are not visible to enterprise agencies. I think that could equally apply to men. Just a lot of people are not visible to enterprise agencies because they don't necessarily go through them. So I think, you know, the enterprise agencies don't necessarily capture everyone. You're absolutely right to say that, you know, when you find examples of successful women in this case, we should be highlighting it. I want to ask you a little bit about the idea of a women's business centre. I think I picked up earlier there was a price tag of 50 million. Somebody mentioned that earlier, £50 million. Given that we're doing pre-budget scrutiny, perhaps you can explain to me why we need a women's business centre when we have existing services which you yourself admit are doing a good job. And I know from my own patch, business support services are doing a good job and do, in many cases, target women.
Okay, well, on your first point in terms of visibility, yes, I think that that's right. There are a number of people who aren't visible in terms of our enterprise agencies. However, in the case of women, what the data tells us is there is a heightened invisibility when you compare that to men coming through. And that really is the case for much of the evidence base in terms of a women's business centre. Many of the issues that we highlight are faced by men. They're common to people starting up in entrepreneurship. But it is the degree to which women face these issues that is different, and that's what the research points to. So, you know, it's important to say that. In terms of a women's business centre, yes, supporting services work well. They work well for the mainstream. They do not work well for women. So, you know, we have 10 years of research and data of women's experiences with mainstream services which simply are not meeting their needs. So in terms of some of the specifics, you know, women will say that, you know, our most recent consultation was just a few months ago in Edinburgh and East Lothian. And there women were telling us that they expected, you know, to get support, they expected to get insight, they expected to have their ideas supported and encouraged, and they didn't. They left feeling less confident about their ideas. They didn't get the assurances they were looking for. They were directed to different places of information. And, you know, in the words of one younger woman, it's daunting enough being a new mum and dealing with that. You know, I didn't want to be signposted to just basically go there and find all that information yourself and then pull it together. So these are the types of examples where mainstream is doing its job. It's working for, you know, arguably the critical majority. It is not working for the considerable amount of women that are now seeking to use its services. So, you know, my point is we need to be smart. We need to leverage what we believe is working already within that infrastructure. But we absolutely need to change and adapt the bits that are not working well. We've got experience from the Digital Women's Business Centre. We set that up at the height of the pandemic, thanks to the private sector support. We were able to do that. We have seen thousands of businesses. We have actually just upgraded that portal because it wasn't designed for the amount of traffic that is coming through it. So, you know, that may help to answer your question. And certainly from our perspective, you know, we see that giving us a really strong bed of information, of engagement that we can lift into the physical model. Because I think, as we all know, digital's been great. It's very effective. It's very efficient. But there is nothing like face-to-face support. And, you know, that is how we are going to set and design our Women's Business Centre on the back of those 10 years of research and data. But the most recent consultation from women telling us where their needs are being met. It's important to say that. Telling us where their needs are not being met and designing the centre to have the maximum impact. We actually work very closely. The first centre I'm talking about that we've consulted on is to be based at Queen Margaret University, just in East Lothian, the border of Edinburgh. And we work very closely with Business Gateway Services in there and with Edinburgh Services. In fact, Business Gateway and East Lothian are actually co-located within the university campus, and it's a really good model for bringing service providers together in one space to leverage the value out of each set of expertise to the benefit of business creation and the economy in Scotland.
Is that where, that's not where the Scottish Government's Women's Business Centre is going to be, is it?
Well, I certainly hope it is.
Yeah, you think it, yeah, it
I'm
is.
I'm going to be lobbying very hard right. that it should be
okay,
there.
Because I was going to ask what stage we're at with that, given that they've pledged to establish one.
We await the insight, you know, in terms of how that's going to be applied. I think, as I said in response to Jamie's question, it's really important that this isn't seen as just a one centre will deliver for everybody. No, we see this as a bit of a hub and spoke model where best practice from regional centres can be pulled into the centre, identified and therefore leveraged back out. So we have that model that works so very well in an economic context, but is able to be flexed according to the needs of each region and each place that it will serve. So that would certainly be our vision in terms of how a Women's Business Centre model could make a significant impact to the economy here in Scotland.
Okay. How am I doing for time? I know we're up against it.
Maybe move over to Colin Beattie, and if there's time, I'll bring you back in, if that's...
Yeah, that's fine.
Just one actually related to Graham Simpson's question. The clarity on the 50 million. So the government said 50 million over 5 years. Is that for the Women's Business Centre?
Well, that's my understanding. Right. Commitment to a Women's Business Centre model, £50 million.
That's the investment that goes along
that
with
is what was the response to our manifesto, which called for a Women's Business Centre model.
Okay, thank you. Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Vera. Good morning. Coming in at the tail end, I've had the opportunity of listening to your very comprehensive replies, and I really must thank you for that. You've covered a lot of ground. But I'd like to ask you just a couple of daft laddie questions. Since ever I can remember, we've been talking about this. We've been talking about support for women and helping them in the workplace and so on. And it seems that over the years, it hasn't been as successful as we might have hoped. And I'd like to ask you the daft laddie question. Why is that? Why is it? When we're all talking about it, why hasn't something more happened? Is it because of lack of money? Is it lack of anything? Because we seem to be talking about it all the time, but not actually making the progress that people would like to see. So maybe Ruth could give us the first thoughts on that.
Yeah, I think that's a fair question, and I think it probably reflects the points that Carolyn and I have made today around prioritisation and leadership and also gender mainstreaming, so ensuring that you're embedding gender equality in all the policies that you're doing. We were really pleased that a few years ago the Scottish Government published the Gender Pay Gap Action Plan, which was the first Gender Pay Gap Action Plan, and that's a really positive indication that the Scottish Government are taking tackling women's labour market inequality seriously. And that plan highlights that the causes of the gender pay gap stretch beyond the workplace and highlights the diverse causes of the gender pay gap around childcare provision, transport, skills, economic development. And we really need gender equality being prioritised across all those areas in order to make progress on women's inequality in the labour market. We can't do this by just focusing on employment policy alone. I think there still remains some barriers here. So often we hear that a key reason why we can't tackle the gender pay gap in Scotland is because we don't have the devolution of employment law. But actually, so many of the causes of the gender pay gap are not unlawful, so therefore sit outside employment law. So these are things like part-time working, women's disproportionate responsibility for childcare, the need for more quality part-time work. And these are all things that we could be doing now. So I think it's about that prioritisation. I think what we see in a lot of strategies and plans that have been published lately is that the Gender Pay Gap Action Plan is having to do increasing heavy lifting in terms of directing action on women's labour market inequality. And what I mean by that is, if we look at the National Strategy for Economic Transformation, that's not well gendered. So it doesn't have a gender analysis of women's experiences of the economy. It doesn't have any specific actions in terms of actually tackling women's inequality in the economy, but it points to the Gender Pay Gap Action Plan. Similarly, one of our critiques of the retail strategy was that it does the same thing. So it's as though all the policy making that has to happen on the labour market is being done by the Gender Pay Gap Action Plan. But actually, what we would like to have seen is the actions and the analysis from Fairer Scotland for Women being mainstreamed throughout all of these strategies, so that it doesn't matter what stakeholder is taking forward the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. When they have that document in their hands, it's explicitly obvious to them that gender equality is something that they should be considering. We really welcome the Scottish Government's continued focus on fair work, and I think that's particularly important in the current context because of all the reasons we've outlined today. But we're clear that the fair work policy frameworks and the supporting tools need to be better gendered if they're to facilitate transformative change for women. Looking at the Fair Work Action Plan, for example, that's not well gendered and doesn't have enough specific actions that would allow us to progress on facilitating fair work for women. I will also say that there is a key role here for employers. So the Scottish Government obviously can have great policies on gender equality, but unless employers are actually taking those forward, then it's only going to be so effective. We know that employer complacency remains a key barrier to actually taking action on women's inequality in the labour market. So employers aren't yet prioritising women's inequality within the workplace. And I think that maybe stems from, again, a lack of understanding of the business case. So all the things that we've put forward today in terms of why gender equality is good for economic growth, it's also good for your business in terms of being able to recruit from a wider talent pool, being more productive, more innovative, but we're not yet seeing employers prioritising that. I think that's demonstrated in terms of equal pay. So we see that 94% of employers have an equal pay policy, but only a third of employers have actually done an equal pay review, which is the methodology for uncovering unequal pay. Similarly, the point I made about gender pay gap reporting, employers are seeing it as being sufficient to merely report their figure rather than seeing that as something that they then have to tackle. So I do think that it's the combination of gender equality not yet being prioritised across all policy areas that would enable a benefit to women's equality at work, and also it's that employers are not yet understanding why they should be prioritising gender equality. And again, if I just return as my final point to the Fair Work Policy Framework, because those supporting tools are not explicitly focused on gender equality, it's very hard to see how employers could operationalise fair work for women within their own workplace.
Ruth, given that we're talking about budgets here and everything at the end of the day comes back to money, the money that has been put against the equality, if and gender equality. Has that been well spent?
It's a very difficult question. I think sometimes, I think Carolyn's touched on this as well, that often when we're funding projects to facilitate gender equality in the workplace, there are very small scale projects that are very difficult to be scaled up. And we were just discussing this before we came into the room, that it's often facilitates change in a very small area, be that geographically or on one particular issue. But the scalability of those projects is more difficult. So, for example, we see a lot of focus in terms of the gender pay gap on getting more young girls and women to study STEM-related subjects so that they can then move into STEM-related roles. However, if we look at the problems with the attrition rate, we see that only 30% of women who have studied STEM actually work in a STEM-related industry. And what that points to instead is problems with employment practice. So STEM-related industries not having high rates of flexible working, for example, or male-dominated workplace cultures not being welcoming to women, which means it's difficult for them to stay in those roles. So when we're directing so much money into getting women to study STEM without tackling those structural issues that actually cement their inequality, perhaps that's the wrong focus. So I think that the money on gender equality to us is always well spent, but there's probably more that we could be doing across a range of areas.
Caroline, do you have a view?
Yep. I think as Ruth said, in terms of the issue, why is it not happening? Because the action we're taking is fragmented. It is not strategic and it's not joined up. So you're getting the odd project over here, you get another odd project over here. They're not connected, the learnings are not coming through, and it is not a strategic investment. So that would be the first point. Where we are running programmes, we're not measuring them. We're not seeing data coming through in terms of the impact of the investment we have made over here or over here in order that we can gain the learnings and the data, and then review that and look at where we can leverage and where we can build from that. And therefore, if we do not have those insights and learnings, there is no change. We shouldn't be surprised at that. We're not setting ourselves up for success. We're choosing to set ourselves up for failure. We're not investing strategically at all. It's strategic, joined-up investment that will deliver success in this field and in every other field. You know, this isn't anything new. This is how, you know, economic development works. It needs to be strategic and joined up. The more strategic and joined up it is, the more you can leverage it, the more you can change the economy. And the other point I do want to make is, because we mentioned earlier having enterprise at the centre of the economic strategy, and I did say I welcomed that. I think one of the issues we're currently facing is that enterprise organisations, like others, are facing budget cuts. So just at the time where we want to catalyse entrepreneurship and support entrepreneurs and small businesses, other organisations that we work with are seeing their budgets cut and are struggling themselves to maintain that support and that operation. And there is an issue there. There is an issue of trust and poor communication. Trust is being eroded, and trust in the enterprise community, between the community and between government, is absolutely vital. And I just want to highlight that when I'm here today, that is a serious issue. We are part of that wider ecosystem. We see the pain that some of these other organisations are going through. We're struggling ourselves as well. And it's important to say that we really need to rebuild that ecosystem, that trust and that communication, so that we can then also capitalise on when the investment comes through.
Thank you. I'll just can ask a brief question at the end. I was having a look at the members' debate that my colleague Michelle Thompson held in May, I think it was. The Minister, in replying, did talk about a project that was investing women angels working with SNB. SNB comes under the remit of this committee about bringing investment. Caroline, do you have any knowledge of where that's, how that is progressing?
I have no knowledge whatsoever, which in itself, I guess, isn't great. There was an announcement. There was an announcement that there would be a women's fund of significant magnitude. It is, I guess, slightly unexpected, because normally if you are going to announce a fund like that, The fund works on the basis of leverage, so you would have your methodology, if you like, or your partners or your investors all lined up when you make that announcement. And we haven't heard anything. There's been an announcement made, nothing has happened, we're not clear where that 12 million is coming from, who is going to be involved in leveraging that, and exactly where it's going to be targeted and what the aspirations are. So I would certainly welcome much more insight, because potentially it could be transformative.
OK, that's helpful. Thank you. I'd like to thank both the witnesses for giving their expertise and insights this morning. That's been much appreciated. I will now move the meeting into the private session.